You know, one of the most darkest moments in scriptures, probably the darkest moment in all of scripture, the darkest moment in the history of time on planet Earth was that moment, well, the moment that began at the arrest of our Savior and continued throughout that night into the next day, and that mockery of a trial that Jesus is put through, and that beating and cursing and spitting and slapping and all that Jesus endured. The scriptures give us detail in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John of that brutal moment in the history of time when our Savior paid a price that he didn't have to pay, but he chose to pay. And throughout that night and his arrest, and as we've looked over the past few weeks of this story, particularly of Peter and his involvement in the life of Jesus and his moment in time on planet Earth, we see that Jesus' followers scatter, they flee, they're scared. Specifically, Peter in this moment is so stressed, he's stressed to the breaking point, and he does something unimaginable. He does something that he had said just a few hours previous that he would never do. He denied his best friend. He said he didn't know him. He was questioned a second time, and he said he didn't know him. And he's questioned a third time, and he even curses while saying he doesn't know him. This brave man who earlier with Jesus on a lake and a storm and a boat steps out of that boat and actually does something no human has ever done before. And he walks on water. This fascinating life that Peter has, and we've, over the last 5 weeks, have been able to see a variety of moments in his life, some celebratory moments and a lot of face-planting moments when he just did the wrong thing. A rooster crows and he remembers the words of Jesus. I can't imagine what that must have been like for Peter. The Bible says that Jesus goes to be crucified and that Peter leaves that scene. As a matter of fact, it says that he leaves in anguish and he weeps bitterly. That, listen church, that could have been the end of the story for Peter. It could have ended there. And the Lord didn't have to tell us in Scripture what was next for Peter. The Lord doesn't have to do anything. He's Lord God. He can do as he pleases, but he specifically not only continues the story in Peter's life, but he gives us a really unique look into a pivotal moment in the story. If you have your Bible, I want to take you, before we pick up where we left off last week in John chapter 1, I want to take you to the last chapter in the book of Mark, because something happens. It's recorded in Mark's gospel, and it's something we don't see in any other gospel. And it's a fascinating moment and a critical moment in the life of Peter that involves two words. In Matthew's gospel, Peter denies Jesus, and we never see anything again about Peter in his gospel. In Luke's gospel, we do briefly see that Peter was one who went to the empty tomb to see, in fact, if Jesus had been raised from the dead. But in Mark's gospel, in this critical moment for all of us, the moment where Jesus pierces the darkness, he steps out of that tomb, he is resurrected and risen, amen, church? It's a beautiful moment in history, and something happens particularly in this moment that Mark describes for us that, I'll be honest, I'm not so sure I had seen before, or if I had seen, I had probably read past it. It's a game changer for Peter, and it's a great part of his epic story. Read along with me. In Mark chapter 16, verse 1, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Jesus has now been in the tomb 3 days. Very early on the first day of the week,
Just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, look at this, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away as they entered the tomb. Can you imagine this moment for these ladies? They saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. I could imagine so. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him?" And can't you imagine this messenger from heaven pointing to this place where Jesus' body had laid? He says, see the place where they laid him? And then he says, "Go, tell his disciples," and do you see the next two words, church? "And Peter." "Tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." In this remarkable moment, guys, I find this fascinating. In a critical moment in time when the resurrection of our Savior is announced to the world, there's only one name mentioned in this moment, one disciple's name mentioned in this moment, and it is the name who? The name Peter, the rock. Evidence, guys, we have seen this. Evidence throughout this study, this epic moment in history for Peter. We have seen time and again Jesus's love, compassion, grace, and calling that he has upon this man, Peter. We've seen so much. Go to John chapter 21. I want to pick up the story where we left off last week. We have just seen so much in this story, specifically of, listen to this, a man who greatly failed Jesus. Greatly failed Jesus, particularly in a time when he was warned that he was going to fail him, and he did it anyway, even though he said he would never do it. Could have been the end of the story, but we see a critical moment when the Savior's resurrection is announced. And that messenger from heaven sure wanted to make sure that not just everybody knew, but that Peter knew the story wasn't over. Guys, there's a couple things I want to give you as we finish this series this morning. I'm so glad you're with us this morning. My name is Jeffrey. I'm one of the pastors here. If you're joining us online, thank you for joining us. It's been a busy week here at church. We had a great night last night. For those of you who were at Candy Palooza, you know it was an awesome night. Hey guys, church, can we applaud for everyone who worked so crazy hard for this church, this community last night? It was a great night. I'm so thankful to Deborah and to her team, and I hope for those of you who weren't here that you'll go on Facebook. We're going to continue to pop some pictures up there. And it was just a fantastic night. I hope you'll go on and you'll comment, you'll share those photos. We had hundreds of people on our campus last night, and it was a fantastic night. But I got to tell you, even though I was loving last night, I was thinking about this morning, because I love where we're headed in Scripture this morning, because there's a few things as we're wrapping this epic series of Peter and his life journey with Jesus that have really spoken to me in this series. And I want to share them with you this morning. And the first is this. I have so clearly seen this. I hope you have seen this. If not, I hope you see it today, that number one, Jesus' plan supersedes my past. And I hope you underline, if you're writing notes this morning, that word supersede. Jesus' plan supersedes my past. We've talked about this for 5 weeks now, that Peter is this flawed man, this man who often speaks before thinking, who acts often with little regard to his actions, a man who commits before thinking about his commitment. Because Scripture is making it so clear to us that Jesus had his hand on this man. And it's not, listen, if you're just joining us this morning, I want you to hear this. We're not just researching Peter's story just to research a neat story in Scripture. No, we see so clearly evidence in Scripture that Peter's story is our story. And that this man, flawed in the midst of his challenges, in the midst of his failures, we see that Jesus was walking hand in hand with him. And I hope you'll take that home with you today, that this isn't just about Peter and his epic moment on earth. Because it's about all of ours. You could even replace Peter with your name in this story, because we've all failed. We all have a past. There's no one in the room clean. Here we clearly see Jesus wanting us to get it, wanting Peter to know it, that, hey, the story's not over. Mark, I'll just go back here real quickly and you guys can just listen. Mark chapter 16, we just read it. But did you capture what verse 5 said? Just listen to this. As they entered the tomb, there was a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they're alarmed. This young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, they're alarmed. We see a similar scene like this in Acts chapter 1. It'd be a great read for your family this week. We really encourage you to spend time as a family in the Word. Acts chapter 1, verse 2. A very similar scene where a young man in a white robe appears as this heavenly messenger, this visitation from God. And so I think it's important for us to pause and consider that this has been a horrific moment. Listen, this is important. This obviously was a horrific moment for Jesus. But we see that heaven, God clearly wants us to understand, specifically wants Peter to know that there's a message for him. This could have been a very selfish moment for Jesus, just coming off of the pain of crucifixion. But yet we see his heart is on his one of his best friends, Peter, who miserably failed him. I hope you'll catch this morning, church. I really tried to wrap my head around this week as I thought about, and foolishly of me to do so, to even try to put thought and words to what crucifixion could be like. But I thought about crucifixion and tried to think about how someone could endure what our Savior endured. And I know we have some young ears in the room this morning, and so some brutal descriptions here. So my apology in advance for this, but at the same point, I'm not so sure that we often pause enough to consider the brutality of what our Savior went through. If you've researched the crucifixion, and I've got so much here, obviously I don't have time to share all of it with you this morning, but as I began to research the crucifixion, I was amazed at the toll the body takes in so many different ways when one is crucified. The victim suffocates to death. There are many theories about how someone being crucified dies, but the most probable one is that the victim actually suffocates. They're hanging on the cross, the weight of the body pulling up, and then having to let go, and that pressure on the diaphragm and how that complicates breathing. It's a tragic, interesting read. The victim would support his weight and push up on his legs, and the leg muscles would eventually tire. He would have to allow his body to hang limp for a while he takes another breath. The nerves in the arms, have you ever thought about this? The nerves in the arms would rub up and down against the metal on those nails when that victim is hanging and pushing and letting go, and there would be a constant rub, and those nerves would send shockwaves throughout this reoccurring pain throughout the entirety of the body, this irritation of the nerves. And then I read about skin and muscle and just the reality that both were ripped off of the person's body before the crucifixion even started. Crucifixion, you know this, it involved more than just nailing one to a tree, but it was that painful process that often happened before the nailing, where this nine-tailed whip had metal tips and bone clingings and rock chips, and it would be connected to that strap, and the executioner would then use that strap and would whip the victim there, often tying first that victim to a wood block. Can you imagine? And often it would be that soldier beating that person, their back, their buttocks, their legs. Sometimes it would rip flesh from their face, the front side of their body. Muscles would retract. This is obviously known as flogging, and sometimes it would last for an extended period of time. And here's what I found brutally grotesque. The purpose of this moment here was to mar the victim beyond recognition, but not take them to the point of death. Then there would be the wooden splinters that would scourge the flesh. There would be extreme shock. The initial beating in and of itself would put the body immediately into shock. This occurs when a person loses about 20% of their blood supply, and that would deplete this lock there would be this loss of oxygen in this person's body. Their heart would try to overcompensate and try to pump more blood. This would result in even less cells actually working properly, and this vicious cycle would continue until the person dies. I had never really thought about this, but oftentimes the person there hanging on the cross would immediately experience shoulder dislocation. This would happen right at the onset of the crucifixion. I dislocated my shoulder water skiing several years ago. Crazy pain, but I can't even begin to imagine the pain in such a moment. This vertical beam, it's already in the ground, and then the victim carries this horizontal beam, and the executioner nails him to it while in the ground, on the ground, and then is lifted up and is connected to that beam and comes slamming down, and therefore, in that moment, when the vertical beam hits, the weight of the hanging body, once raised, just pulls the shoulders out of socket. Then there's cardiac stress, there's hyperventilation, there's muscle cramping, there's pain in the vital organs. Guys, I could go on and on. Crucifixion was more painful than just three nails. It was an excruciating way to suffer and to die. Jesus endured all of this having never done anything wrong. Do we think about this enough? We should. Jesus endured all of this, having never done anything wrong. And he did this for you and for me. And he did this for Peter. And in this resurrection moment, we see the messenger delivering a message for Peter, specifically the one who played a part in his death. We all played a part. Our sins nailed him to the cross. I find this amazing. How could Jesus do this? This messenger who came from heaven sure wanted Peter to know, Peter, I'm still in it with you. Jesus hadn't even seen Peter yet. But before that introduction, after the moment of denial, before Peter and Jesus see one another again, Jesus is already taking steps to let Peter know, I forgive you. The messenger is delivering this amazing message. Jesus' plan supersedes my past. And church, it's so important that you know this morning. The same is true for you. With Jesus, your past is in the past. You should be writing that this morning. My past is in the past. As a matter of fact, say it with me this morning. Everyone say this. My past is in the past. I hope you'll circle that this morning, church. I hope you'll circle it. John chapter 21, we ended last week with this amazing moment. Jesus is appearing to his disciples again, and he joins them while they're fishing. It's a miraculous catch for them. In John 21, we read a little bit of this story yesterday. Jesus shows up and he cooks for them. Let's jump back in and finish this part of the story and finish this time with Peter in Scripture in this series. Verse 15 says, they had finished eating. Jesus has cooked breakfast for them. The best breakfast ever. Jesus has cooked for them. When they finish eating, Jesus says to Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? The scriptures tell us that Peter was hurt. Look at this. Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things and you know that I love you. Listen to Jesus' words here. A forecasting of what is to come in Peter's life. Jesus said, feed my sheep. And then he says, very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted. But when you were old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. There, Jesus is obviously telling Peter that he's going to die in a similar way, that his hands are going to be stretched out. He's going to be led where he doesn't want to go. A moment of crucifixion is coming for Peter. couple things I want to give you guys as we finish this morning. Secondly, not only did Jesus' plan supersede my past, but Jesus' plan shapes my preparation. It's what we see here with Peter. It's really what his story's been about preparing him, about getting him ready. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself, you went where you wanted, but Jesus is telling him, but when you're old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. A prediction that Peter is going to die a terrible death. Here's what I find amazing about this, guys, is I've spent some time in Scripture reading this week and just really allowing the Scriptures and the Gospels and then into Acts. If you've got some time this week, I hope you'll make some time to get into Acts and read about what happens next in Peter's story. We're really not going there in detail. That might be a great series for us in 2021. But I really started just looking at the timetable, and I think I'm appropriately correct here. Jesus gives Peter this foretelling of what is to come. And Peter, have you thought about this? He goes to work for three more decades. For three more decades working for Jesus, sharing the good news with this knowledge in his head that his death is coming. Can you imagine? For three more decades, he has this prediction hanging over his head. I can't imagine what that must have been like for Peter. I mean, sometimes I have a hard time just focusing when somebody walks in the room and there's a TV on. Amy will tell you this, if the TV on, usually it's got my attention. My focus goes in a lot of different places real quickly. I can't imagine for Peter staying the grind and staying focused, knowing the prediction that his Savior gave him. How did this happen? Guys, this is a critical breakfast for Peter, and it's a big moment for all of us as Christ followers. Because the equipping for Peter, it's been happening in his whole epic moments with Jesus, but this is the epic moment. This is the epic moment. This breakfast right here, this was that moment of preparation where Jesus and Peter, a critical moment that defined the rest of his life. Jesus is telling him, hey, trouble's coming, but I want you to stay the course. And guys, I think this is a timely word for us this morning as Christ followers. If you're a Christian and you're in the room, then you know this is a critical moment in history, an election a few days away, a COVID-19 that's ripping its way still across our nation and around our world. There's uncertainty. There's not a person in this room who hasn't been impacted by COVID. There's some in this room who have loved ones sick here right now. There's some in this room who have loved ones who've lost a job because of COVID. There are some here who are dealing with challenges that you've shared with no one. Almost every day in my office here since becoming privileged to be one of the pastors here on campus, my phone rings or I get an email or a text from someone dealing with something. Amy and I last night had such a privilege to stand at one of the stations. We prayed for every family who came through, even those who looked at us a little odd, Johnny, and wondered why we were praying for them. When the prayer got done, they said thank you. I think every car, Amy said thank you. We are in a place as a society, even though we don't need or necessarily know that we need prayer, we do know we need prayer. We are hungry for change, for hope, and we saw it right there last night when all these people came on this campus and all this work that went into it, guys. It was for that moment. Amy and I were so privileged. Troy was in on some of those prayers as well. Bailey and Brennan were there. What a privilege. Listen, guys, I love being a pastor at a church that understands the privilege we can offer our community of just praying over them. I wish we could do it every weekend. We are a society of people hungry for hope and for change. It is tough times. You know it is tough times. We shouldn't expect otherwise. The church is under attack. Your family is under attack. God's word is under attack. The life of the unborn is under attack. Our kiddos are under attack. Our marriages are under attack. Our purity is under attack. We are under attack. Jesus is warning us. He's warned us through his words about this. If you can, real quickly, go to John chapter 15. We see these warnings all throughout Scripture. It's almost time for me to get a new Bible. My pages keep falling apart here. But look at this. This is John chapter 15, verse 18. We looked at this passage a few weeks ago. Jesus talking, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. Hey guys, this is so fitting for us because we are in such a social media dysfunction on planet Earth right now where everybody wants to be famous. And everybody's looking for their American Idol moment, especially our young generation. And they bought into this vicious lie that the more likes, the more hits, the more people they meet online, the better they feel about themselves. And boy, Satan's brilliant at what he does. I'm not saying social media is bad. Now, it can be used in a negative way in our lives. And I think Satan's winning the war right now because so many of us are buying into it. We as a church want to use it as a way to share the love of Christ, and we're trying to be more effective in that. We encourage you to do the same. But there is this madness on our planet, everyone believing that everyone must like them. Christ followers, let me remind you, you know this, but I so want to remind you, we're not here to be famous. And Jesus is saying this. If you belong to this world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world. And I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. Look at what Jesus says in John chapter 16. These two chapters, by the way, John 15 and 16, just a fantastic read for your family to read just about the warning Christ gives us of the world and the times we're in. Look at chapter 16. Look at verse 20. Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come, but when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice. We could read on and on and on, church. Jesus giving this warning to the church, to his followers. Specifically, he's about to go to the cross there. But we, guys, we see the evidence. You know this, of where we are today in culture, not to hang heavy on this, but it's an important part of our journey here as a church because these are troubled times. We were so disappointed to not come back to life groups this morning. I know many of you were disappointed. I was disappointed to have to send that email. We want to err on the side of your safety, and so we encourage life groups to continue to meet via Zoom. Some are meeting socially distanced in person, and so we want to lead well, and so we're just going to kind of watch the numbers from week to week, and we may pull a quickie on you and announce the night before that we're going to try to get back at life groups. So always be watching your emails. If you're not getting emails from us, contact the church. We want to make sure we've got you in the rhythm of hearing from us. But guys, we so desire for us to be together, not just in this room, but prayerfully, corporately, as a family of believers, because we just know we all need it. All of you, you're hungry to walk up right now to someone and give them a hug. It's been a long time since some of you have hugged anyone in this room. I haven't really hugged any of you, and I'm new here, and I want to hug all of you. These are challenging times. But guys, I sure hope that you see that last night, Candy Palooza is one example of us desiring to be a church that reaches out, that looks outward to our community. We want to equip the next generation. Amen. Our Kids First ministry, our student ministry. We've got an announcement coming in just a few days about a student pastor we want you to be praying for that we're going to bring to the church in just 2 weeks. We're so excited for this. Last night was evidence of our love for this community, and we want to love our students well. Our college ministry with Luke and Megan, there's just so many exciting things happening that are really going to help us be the church we can be for the next generation to come. And I want to give you just a good highlight of that. Some of you were on our campus last night, and you saw how awesome that moment was. Some of you, maybe you weren't here. Well, I just kind of want you to experience a minute and 41 seconds of last night's goodness. So I want you to take a look at what God did, because so many people worked to pour out to the next generation, all the kiddos who were on our campus last night. It was awesome to see them and their families. I want you to take a look. It was such a great night, such a great night.
Good time. Slept
What a great night that was. Guys, again, can you just applaud those who made last night possible? It was just such a wonderful night. I love looking at those pictures. I hope, guys, that you see that at Donaldson First, we just truly believe that it's one of our most critical responsibilities to love every generation, but to be about preparing the next generation. We see that here with Jesus, that this moment on the beach with Peter was about preparation, not about his past, about preparation for what was next. Number three, let me give you another one. Jesus' plan, I love this, solidifies my purpose. It solidifies my purpose. I was so excited to answer my phone Tuesday afternoon. Jill DeVay, she called me. I hope you guys are praying for her. We have, as I mentioned earlier, so many in our family who just need prayer, and Jill sends her love to you. She says thank you. She's in rehab right now. She can't have any visitors right now, so it's really tough on her. I just hope you'll lift her up in prayer. But she called me, and she said, and I wrote this down. She said, Jeffrey, I'm in a lot of pain, but I know, and I could hear the excitement in her voice, even with her pain, and half of her body is numb when she's telling me this. She's explained just how things are feeling and the pain and the numbness, and she said, I'm in a lot of pain, but I know this more than I ever have. And when she said it, I wanted to share the story with you because I knew where we were going in Scripture today. She said, God has a purpose for my life, or I wouldn't have survived what just happened to me. Amen. God has a purpose for my life. And I said, Jill, you're right. And it reminded me to tell you, that's the case for all of us, church. If you're breathing, there is a purpose for your life. And we see Peter here, beachside, eating breakfast with Jesus. It was nothing about the fish. It was nothing about the load of fish they brought in. It was about that moment of Jesus pouring into him, of Jesus preparing him, equipping him, solidifying Peter's purpose. Look at verse 15. So Jesus says, do you love me? And Peter says, yes. And he says, feed my lambs. And he says it again, do you love me? And he says, yes. And he says, take care of my sheep. A third time, he says, do you love me? Hey, guys, why three times? I've often asked this question. Why did Jesus ask Peter three times? Well, I can't tell you that I've got the exact answer. I mean, maybe it had to do with the Trinity. A lot of people tell me that. I've researched some other places that say maybe it was because Peter denied Jesus three times. Maybe. I don't know that we'll know this side of heaven for sure, but I do know this. The repetition wasn't for Jesus' sake. It was for Peter's sake. Jesus didn't need to know what he already knew. It wasn't for Jesus. It was for Peter. And Jesus wanted Peter to know, Peter, I forgive you. Peter, I believe in you. And Peter, I'm in it with you. Oh, how this moment must have solidified Peter's purpose. This man who just a few days previous had crumbled under pressure when Jesus was arrested. Guys, he goes on to live this most amazing, epic story. I wish we had time to dive deep into it. I've already said it once, but we're probably going to go there next year because I love the story of the Acts and these disciples that ran scared for their lives, and now they're out literally giving their lives. We know this about Peter, that breakfast and that moment, it so shaped his purpose. In Acts 2, you know this, Peter preached this amazing message, and in one day, 3,000 people got saved. Can you imagine if that happened right here? That wasn't the end of the story. In Acts 3, after God healed a lame man in Solomon's colonnade, it's a really great read, Peter preaches again, and more than 5,000 people are saved. And then in Acts chapter 4, listen to this. This is verse 12. Peter preaches this. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Peter literally, his life is on the line. In that moment, he's standing before the Sanhedrin, and he's saying, guys, it ain't about y'all. It's about Jesus, y'all. That's why we put that on a shirt. It's about Jesus, y'all. It ain't about y'all. It's about Jesus, y'all. And Peter fearlessly stood up, and he says, there is no other name that offers salvation but the name of Jesus Christ. Guys, this study really comes to this moment on the beach. This beginning in Acts of the rest of Peter's epic story was shaped and prepared and solidified and chiseled into this moment. Here's what I find amazing, and then we'll finish. Here's what I find amazing about this moment with Jesus and Peter on the beach. Not once does Jesus talk about Peter's past. Not once. Not once does Jesus bring up where Peter had been or what he had done. No, we see so clearly that Jesus, on point as always, was preparing Peter for the next chapter. And guys, that's the take home for me. Feed my lambs, take care of my sheep, feed my sheep. Why sheep? Johnny, why sheep? I've thought about this. Why sheep? You ever thought about this? Why sheep? Well, on a really, really poor, probably choice of content moments, it really gives me an opportunity to give you guys, as we finish this morning, some really bad sheep jokes. For instance, what do you call a sheep with a machine gun? A bad situation. What animal sounds like a sheep but isn't? A baboon. What do you call a sheep that is always quiet? A sheep. This one's for my father-in-law. What do you call a religious sheep? A Baptist. There you go. That's all I got. That's all I got, guys. Why sheep? Seriously. You know, I think the simple of it is, you guys know this, if you know anything about sheep, you pretty much know that a sheep cannot find grass on its own. It must be led. It has to be shepherded. Otherwise, it'll wander off, go hungry, be eaten, fall off a cliff. And we see that Jesus gives us this opportunity, this glimpse, not only into the next chapter of Peter's epic story, but Christians, listen, for all of us, that we are called to go and to lead the sheep of this world. Candy Palooza was a part of that last night. To lead people who don't know him. A moment in history unlike any other moment. A breakfast unlike any other breakfast. Jesus could have given up on Peter, but he didn't. And guys, that's where really the send-off for us this morning begins. The reminder that my epic story isn't defined by my past. Listen, my epic story isn't defined by my past. My epic story is one that is truly worth living. Because listen, my epic story is one that is still being written. Church, your take home this week is that reminder that that same Jesus who met with Peter and cooked breakfast for him on that beach. It's the same Jesus who wants you to know, I forgive you. I love you. And I'm in it with you. Amen? Will you bow your heads with me this morning?